I bring you greetings from Community of Faith Bible Church, and I'm just delighted to be here with you all. I preached at a conference this past Wednesday in North Carolina, and he asked me to preach on a sobering topic. They asked me to lecture through the fall of King David. And what a timely word for just our church today, with a series of very prominent evangelical leaders falling. And so when Jason called and asked if I'd preach here, I just said, well, Jason, I'm going to have this sermon in my heart. And he said, fine, come and preach. And it's a timely word for not just leaders and pastors like I preached to last week, but because the Bible calls pastors in 1 Timothy 3 to model what God wants for believers to live like, then living a life of purity is something for pastors and obviously something for a congregation. Pastors need to model and say, like Paul, follow me as I follow Christ. And so I want to encourage us that from the grace that God has given us through Christ, that our leaders and our churches can live a life of fighting and overcoming the temptations associated with sexual impurity. And I'm going to invite you to bow with me now, because I need God's help. We need God's help in this fight, in this battle. Amen? Amen. Father, we are your people. We are purchased by the blood of Christ. We're not alone. You've given us your Son, and you've given us your Spirit who fills us and who guides us, so that, Lord, we can now, by your grace, say no to temptations. And I pray that you'd move in our hearts and our midst, even through the preaching of your word now, and bring about, Lord, just the grace and strength we need and this church needs to be a pure church, honoring you and glorifying you. We ask this in Christ's name, I pray. Amen. 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 And what has become a classic sermon written a couple decades ago, it's titled "The Almost Inevitable Ruin of Every Minister and How to Avoid It." Donald Whitney wrote this: almost everyone knows someone who used to be in the ministry. Almost everyone knows someone who shouldn't be in the ministry. And every minister knows another minister, if not several, he does not want to be like. So I think it's important to address the subject of the almost inevitable ruin of every minister and how to avoid it. And then he continues and says, once when a Southern Baptist denominational executive was asserted this and gave these statistics that showed that from every 20 men who enter the ministry, by the time those men reach age 65, only one will be standing in the ministry. It is shocking. And I pray that that's not true today, but there is a battlefield that we are in, and it's filled with landmines. And what we need to be able to do is, by God's people, is we need to be able to see, how is it that we stand? How is it that we overcome temptation? And we're making a deadly error in Christendom, in our evangelical circles today. We're thinking that some of our celebrity pastors are standing because of their charisma, their gifted oratorical skills, their personality. But that's not the case. There's no good thing in anyone's flesh. That anyone who stands, from the newest church member to our most recognized pastors, stand for one reason: is because of God's grace. And the text of the Bible makes it really clear about King David. And I'll read you a couple of verses. Don't turn there. I'll cite them. In 1 Samuel chapter 18, verse 12, it tells us, now Saul was afraid of David, for the Lord was with him. It says in verse 14 of the same chapter, the same thing: for the Lord was with him. It says in verse 28 that the Lord was with David. And then 2 Samuel chapter 8, verse 6, it says the Lord gave David victory wherever he went. And verse 14 adds that the Lord helped David wherever he went. And so pastors, Christians, we stand, we're standing by the grace of God. But the second we drift away from that same grace, Jesus said, apart from me, you can do nothing. Nothing means nothing. And sometimes we can get shocked by the reality of that truth, but it's God's grace that keeps us, and it will keep us when we say humbly dependent upon God. But when we drift, saints, and when we turn away from our Lord and rely upon our own resources, our own wisdom, our own strength, and our own might, it is a horrible, deadly, far fall that we're looking at. And the higher we lift up some of our celebrity pastors, if they somehow sense in some way that it's because of me, then the higher we lift them up, the farther we will see them fall. And that's the case of David. And I want us to look at some critical lessons so that we can learn and be sobered by. To be forewarned is to be forearmed. And I pray that this text will help us battle in the war that is raging all around us and is a battle for our own purity. And the first critical lesson in this text is found in verse 1. And it says, then it happened in the spring, at the time when kings go out to battle, that David sent Joab and his servants with him and all Israel. And they destroyed the sons of Ammon and besieged Rabbah. But David stayed at Jerusalem. And the first critical lesson here is that David enjoyed what I'm going to call undisciplined leisure time. And I'll say it this way in terms of a critical lesson. Undisciplined leisure time will lead to a moral failure. And I'm not saying that pastors don't need time away. Jesus took time away. It says of our Lord that he would get tired. He walked from Jerusalem to Samaria. It's kind of a 20-mile walk. Anybody would be tired. But he was tired and he needed rest and he slept. And he often took time away as need be just to refresh. Pastors need that. They need sabbaticals. They need to have visiting pastors come and preach for them. They need vacations. They need times with their family away in prayer and in the word to be refreshed. But it has to be careful. It can't be undisciplined leisure time. In my early years in ministry, I would take vacations, and I'm like, well, I'm a pastor. What am I taking a vacation from? I can't take a vacation from reading the Bible and prayer. And if we do that for a second, we'll find ourselves being drained of the strength that God gives us and find ourselves vulnerable in ministry. Being a pastor is like being on a yo-yo. You have highs, tremendous highs. One minute you're doing a wedding, and then in the next minute I'm standing at a graveside with a wife saying her final goodbyes to her husband that she's been with for 50 years. My computer keeps wanting to talk to me, so let me see if I can turn this thing off. Just one of us can have a conversation at a time. All right, it's like, it's being difficult too. Is this it? I just got this new laptop and I don't know, this iPad, and I don't know how it works. All right, so that's when you get like a 60-year-old pastor trying to be like techie and I can't do it anyway, so. So my kids, I'm like, I have six kids. I'm like, honey, can you like show me how to turn off my laptop? So you have these highs and these lows, these victories. I'm baptizing someone in one moment, and then in the next moment, I'm church disciplining someone. And pastors get strained emotionally, and they need time away. And I knew of one pastor, his time away was the golf course. He had a great handicap because he played golf all the time. And the church says, pastor, you need to be in the office. Pastor, you can't miss this meeting. Pastor, you need to, and it kept warning him, and his handicap kept getting better and better. Finally, they had to fire him because he kept playing golf. So we need to have leisure time. But this text says that when kings go out to battle, David sent his general, he sent his servants, in this context, I'll say soldiers, and he sent all Israel. Every able-bodied man went out to battle when kings would go out to battle, but then the text says, but David. When God is calling us and affirming us, you don't want a but after that. It says, Solomon loved the Lord, but he kept the high places. You don't want a but after it says, Bobby loves the Lord, but, or you love the Lord, but. You don't want to see this. And here the text is saying that kings should have been out fighting for the Lord. They should have been out fighting, protecting Israel. David should have been leading his soldiers, not staying at home, verse 2 says, doing what he was doing. It says, not when evening came, David arose from his bed. Did you hear that? Not when morning came, when evening came. So Israel is out at battle. They're out fighting. They're risking their lives. And David is at home fighting the sheets. It's just not a good look. And here you see the first step. When leaders fall, it's not some all of a sudden blowout. Here, this critical lesson tells us undisciplined leisure time can lead to moral failure. Paul would tell Timothy, suffer hardship with me as a good soldier of Christ Jesus. No soldier in active service entangles himself in the affairs of everyday life so that he may please the one who enlisted him as a soldier. This is wartime. And David, because he decided to stay home and sleep, he'll find himself in the greatest battle and war that he had ever faced. And that leads to my second critical lesson. And it's in verse 2. And the text here tells us, now when evening came, David arose from his bed and walked around on the roof of the king's house. And from the roof he saw a woman bathing. And the woman was very pleasing, very beautiful in appearance. Literally, it's just that she was pleasing to look at. So she's very pleasing to look at because his roof was higher than her roof. He can now see a woman bathing. And here the critical lesson to learn is that looking, and I'm being careful as I say this, looking, not seeing, will lead to moral failure. That we can be tempted. A bird can land on your head, but you have to let it build a nest. Here, as David looks, he doesn't stop looking. He doesn't turn his head. And when here the text says, when he's having this undisciplined leisure time, it's like binging on Netflix. Eventually, you're going to see something you shouldn't see. Or taking your phone and surfing through Instagram. Eventually, you're going to see something you shouldn't see. Having undisciplined leisure times opens you up to this temptation now of seeing things you'll be tempted in your lust to look at. But to do so can lead to a moral failure. So Job made a covenant with his eyes not to look upon a virgin, that we have to draw the battle lines where the battle is. And Satan knows if he can get you to look, then he can get you to think. And if he can get you to think, then he can get you to lust. And so we've got to draw the battle line where the battle line is in our current cultural context, that a PG-13 movie definitionally means that they will have some, they can have non-sexual nudity. That you can have the most beautiful women that we can find, and you can put them on a 1,000-foot screen and have them completely naked and call that a PG-13 movie. And here, if we're to learn anything from David, we need to learn the lesson that the Bible gives us in its first chapters, that when Adam and Eve tried to cover up their nakedness with fig leaves, it didn't quite work. That God made them a tunic, a gown, it's almost like a priestly robe to cover up their nakedness. That outside the garden, nakedness becomes a great temptation for us to sin because we lack the discipline and self-control to be monogamous in one woman types of men and women. And so we have to fight the battle where the battle rages. And the battle begins with our eyes. And here David is not only like battling, he's pleasing his eyes, looking at a woman who was not his wife, who was pleasant to look at. You know, my kids were growing up, I always had some type of filter for our TV. ClearPlay does it. You can literally block out anything you want, language, violence, taking the Lord's name in vain, sex scenes, nudity. So I had that, and you can get Angel Vid or Vid Angel, something like that today. And my kids would always complain because, you know, you can see the person's mouth move, and like, Dad, I can see what they're saying. Like, it's not. I said, this isn't just for you. This is for me. That being a pastor doesn't make you immune. It doesn't make you immune from the temptations of your own flesh. And I found myself, and this is one reason why I do that, looking at like PG-13 non-nudity scenes, and I'm like, and they're inappropriate. And I'm like, what are you doing? And so I'm confessing this, and I'm getting pulled in. Whatever we yield ourselves to, we yield ourselves to as a master. Paul says that clearly in Romans, that what we are obeying becomes a master, and sin is a cruel master. And so we have to fight the battle where the battle is. And this is a life and death battle that David is now in. And so we've got to draw the battle line where it is, and we've got to fight the battle with what we're allowing ourselves to see. Looking, not seeing, will lead to moral failure. And then third critical lesson, pride will lead to moral failure. In verse 3, the word of God says, so David sent, he has seen her, and he stares at her, and now she's in his heart. And so the text says, David sent and inquired about this woman. And one of his servants came and said, is this not Bathsheba, the daughter of Eliam, the wife of Uriah the Hittite? And in so many words, what the servant is saying is, David, you're the king. You can have culturally any woman that you want. But this woman is off basis. And what you're finding out here is that David is not, he's moving because he has already moved. That the text says in 2 Samuel chapter 2, it says in verse 2 that when David became king over Judah, he had two wives. It tells us in the next chapter, and I don't know how much time passed, but in chapter 3, verses 2 through 5, it says he has six wives. And then in chapter 5, verse 13, it says, meanwhile, David took more concubines and wives from Jerusalem. Now he's got more wives and more concubines. That here David has been filling his heart with women. If I were to ask you what happens if you kick over a trash can, and I say, well, what comes out if you kick over a trash can? And everybody says, what? Trash. No. What if the trash can is in the athletic room and you filled it with ice for your athletes? What if the trash can is at a church picnic and you put a liner in it and you have sodas in it? The only thing that comes out of a trash can when you kick it over is what you put inside of it. David here now under this temptation, women have filled up his heart. But it's not women who allowed David to defeat all of his enemies. It's not women that exalted David and made him king. God, by his grace, exalted David. And David now is not filling his heart with God. He's not fighting fire with fire. David is turning now as king. He's going to delight himself in the pleasures of men, as it were. As many women as he wanted. But David, if one doesn't satisfy, if two doesn't satisfy, if three doesn't satisfy, at some point you got to say, this is not what satisfies my heart. And if the wives you have don't, maybe God didn't design it for women to replace, God didn't design women to place him as the source of our satisfaction. And you're simply digging a hole that has no bottom to it. And so David, he wants this woman. But the servant tells him, but she's married, David. That's a capital offense even for kings. Adultery was punishable by death. And so the servant warns him. And then the servant says, and she is the wife of Uriah. And he's one of your mighty men, David. You just sent him out to risk his life for you in this kingdom. Eliam is also her father. And you sent him out, and he's one of your mighty men. And the text doesn't say this, but Eliam's father was Ahithophel. David, he is your personal counselor. He's in the office next door. That's her granddaughter. And brothers and sisters, every time we choose to look illicitly at something, it is somebody's wife. It is somebody's daughter. That I had a friend whose daughter just ran off, and so she was in the porn industry, and he pleaded with the congregation and said, don't look, it might be my daughter. And here David is looking at a man's wife. But he's not just looking, he's wanting. He's wanting to take her. And his servant literally warns him, David, don't do it. But he's the king. When you're the king, you're in charge. You can get what you want, but always at a cost. And Satan always leaves off the price tag. So pastors need to know that. God gives us what he gives us by his grace. We don't merit it. We don't deserve it. And we can't replace God. as a source of our satisfaction. Pride will tempt us to say that. And well did Bunyan say, watch out for the little sins. It started with a PG-13 movie. But David. And God doesn't move. With his gracious, nail-scarred hand, he's always there. He's given us the Holy Spirit who's with us. But what do we do? We can start to drift. God satisfied me, but now I want this, and I want this, and I'm turning to this, and we simply walk away from God and find ourselves in a place where when the winds and the storms and the trials and the rains fall, that we can't stand, because apart from Christ, we can do nothing. And so here David is, filled with pride, wanting to take another man's wife. And so the servant warns him, so of course he's going to stop. He's King David, a man of the God's own heart. He's going to say, oh, no, but there's no good thing in your flesh. Isn't it? So you've been a Christian for 10 years, and you think, oh, I've been a Christian for 10 years, so now I can look. You can be a Christian for 1,000 years, and you can't defeat sin apart from Christ. That we always just have to yield to Christ. We always have to depend upon Christ. Why? Because it's Christ. It's Christ who saves. It's Christ who sanctifies. It's Christ who blesses. It's Christ who guards. It's Christ who renews. It's Christ. And it's never us. And so here we have, in his pride, he thinks it's him. And he gets what he wants. And that leads to another critical lesson. Not only do we need to be aware of the undisciplined leisure time can lead to a fall. And looking, not seeing, but looking, can lead to a fall, and pride can lead to a moral failure, but lust. Fourth, lust will lead to a moral failure. So here, David's heart is just inflamed with this beautiful woman that he sees, and regardless of the cost and the consequences and the warning, he wants her. And so it says in verse 4, David sent messengers and took her. And the took her is important. I know our translations might be different, but it is took her. Now, I don't know what to say about Bathsheba. The text doesn't say a whole lot about Bathsheba. It's not talking about Bathsheba. It's talking about David. And what it says about David is clear, that he took her. He's the king. And he used his authority, and he abused his authority, and he took her. And you ask the simple question, David, didn't you write Psalm 23? David, didn't you write all these beautiful songs? David, didn't you have fellowship like we have at Kindred? David, don't you love the Lord, David? So you can ask that question. Well, what's going on then, David? What's going on with David goes on with all of us. That the consummation hasn't happened yet. There is the perishable, our perishable, hasn't put on the imperishable. Our corruptible hasn't put on the incorruptible. So we have to fight. And fight for our lives. And we can't coast. Or else we can find ourselves in a place where we're yielding ourselves to lust and there's nobody to blame. The text is not blaming Bathsheba. If there's an inappropriately dressed woman or a man who flirts with you and says something inappropriate, my husband doesn't talk to me like that when I'm at home, and this guy, every day you come into the job, he's saying, how beautiful you are, and you start getting excited to show up to work, to hear the flattering words from this coworker again, and he starts to entice your heart, so he invites you out to lunch, and he talks to you, and your husband's like, oh, how's your day? Oh, it was fine. That's all you get out of your husband. But this guy wants to talk and spend time, and you find yourself now being romantically connected. And it's not your husband's fault. This is not Bathsheba's fault. This is the fault of David, that he filled his heart with women. Christ will enable you to fight through the hard seasons of your marriage. Christ will enable you to just turn your eyes when you're being tempted. The Bible says this in James chapter 1, verse 14 and 15, and it has to be clear. You won't fight if you have an excuse. We don't try to kill any enemy that we fall in love with. And so we fall in love with all the stuff Hollywood and the porn industry wants to show us, then you won't put it to death. But it says here in James where the problem comes from, James 1, 14 and 15, but each person is tempted when he is drawn away and enticed by what, everybody? His own evil desires. It's our desires that lead us away. So if you can put liver in front of me all day, and I'm not tempted at all. But if you put some fried chicken wings in front of me, and you try to get one of them, you might have a problem. I used to be a bodybuilder in my teens, and one of the challenges with bodybuilding is, you know, it's fun to lift and all that kind of stuff and get big and all that. But for the competition, you have to get crazy lean. I would get down to like 5%. I've gotten down to 2% body fat, which isn't healthy. So I'm eating 500 calories a day. And you dream about food. I mean, just all I can do is think about food. Like, oh, gosh, if I could only have a donut. And so one day, I actually did this. One day I said, okay, Bobby, I'm not going to eat a donut. I just wanted to look at a donut. That's what I told myself. So I go to the donut shop, and I'm like looking at all the donuts. And then now I can look at it, but I can also smell the donuts now. And then smelling the donuts, I told myself at that point, like, you know what? I've been training really hard. One donut won't hurt. So you eat one donut, and after you eat one donut, what do you tell yourself? Well, I failed today, so it doesn't matter. So you eat two dozen donuts, I'll start again tomorrow. And the text makes it clear, this is how we sin, that you're carried away by your lusts. And this is fishing and hunting terminology. It's a fish that sees the worm and wants the worm and thinks it can get the worm and not get stuck on the hook. And so it carries us away. My lust, it draws me away till I now can have it. It says in verse 15, then after desire has conceived, it gives birth to sin. And when sin is fully grown, it gives birth to death. David didn't follow the Lord. He just followed his lust. And he followed his lust all the way across the red line of taking a married woman's wife, taking a married woman. And it says in Deuteronomy 17:17, God says kings shouldn't multiply wives to themselves. But culturally, they let him do it. And culturally, our culture will let you look at and do all kinds of things that'd be disastrous for your purity. And so we've got to learn these critical lessons. That here, the text goes on, it says, David took her, and it says, and when she came, I'm in verse 4, to him, he lay with her, and when she had purified herself from her uncleanness, she returned to her house. And so David here, he's breaking the 10th commandment, coveting someone else's wife. Now he breaks the 7th commandment and commits adultery. And this is King David. And so the warning is, sin is not a respecter of persons. It's an equal opportunity vice. That if the wisest man in the Bible fell to sexual sin, if the strongest man in the Bible, Samson, fell to sexual sin, if a man of the God's own heart like David fell to sexual sin, do you think you're immune? Do you tell yourself, this had never happened to me? I don't have to keep safeguards. I can travel alone. I can spend time with people from the opposite sex. I don't have to have boundaries and limits because I'm a Christian and I love Jesus and I'm safe. I'm sure David thought that sin would never conquer him like this. But the Bible here is giving us this candid, detailed story so that we can be forewarned and forearmed. And so David now commits the sin, and then it tells us in verse 5, she comes to David and said that I am pregnant. So he's exposed. What he did in the dark secretly, he's exposed. He's caught. So of course he's going to repent now that she's pregnant. And I thought I got away with it. But what does he do? He doesn't confess. He doesn't repent. He breaks the 9th commandment. David starts lying, and lying, here's my next critical lesson, lying will lead to moral failure. That lying is kind of, it lets you do all kinds of second sins. If you're not going to tell the truth and confess it, then you don't have to be, like, ashamed. You can just do it and cover it up and keep a facade of righteousness and show up to church and smile, and everybody thinks everything is great. So here David is going to try to lie and cover it up, and the way he does it is beyond evil. He sends a message to Joab, the general, in verse 6, and says, send Uriah. And so David asks Uriah, and this was the pretense, the lie, about, hey, how's the war going? How's everybody doing? As if he brought him home just to catch up on the details of the battle. But that's not why he brought him home. He brought him home and he wanted him to go and to sleep with his wife. So when the news was pronounced that she was pregnant, everybody would think Uriah did it and David was off the hook. But verse 9 says, Uriah slept at the door of the king's house with all the servants of his lord and did not go down to his house. But now when they told David, saying, Uriah did not go down to his house, and David said to Uriah, have you not come from a journey? Why do you not go down to your house? In verse 11, Uriah said to David, the ark and Israel and Judah are staying in temporary shelters, and my lord Joab, the servants of my lord are camping in the open field. Shall I then go to my house to eat and to drink and to lie with my wife? And then he makes an oath, by your life, king, and by the life of your soul, I will not do this thing. Uriah said, there is a holy war going on, David, that my fellow soldiers are risking their lives for Israel and the glory of God. How dare I make this a leisure time? This is not leisure time, David. This is wartime. And so because of his fear of God and wanting to exalt God and protect the nation, he denies himself the pleasure of his own wife. And David, who is the king and is not his wife, and it is a wartime, did not even deny himself. There's a deceitfulness to sin, and it makes it hard. And we just have to fight. And here David sees this example in front of him of this righteous man. And you would think, how convicted must David have been? Surely now David is going to repent. Surely now David is going to confess. Of course he will. Wouldn't you? Be careful how you answer that. That sin is powerful. And here David, instead of repenting, it says in verse 13, David called him, he ate and drank before him, and David kept giving him another glass, and got him drunk, thinking that now drunk, he wouldn't have the self-control to stay away from his wife. But the Spirit of God gives us self-control. It doesn't come from our flesh. It comes from God. And Uriah is a righteous man. He wants to honor God. And God is blessing him with the self-control. So he did not go to his own house. So even drunk, that he finds, not in himself, Uriah finds in God the discipline now to keep his oath that he made to David. That he simply said, I'm not going to do this, David. And David got him drunk. I'm not going to do this, David. And so it's not in our own strength. But beloved, we have to believe that God, through the work of his Spirit and his grace, can teach us to say no to temptation. He can do that. But in our flesh, you'll never win. And so here Uriah, he doesn't go down to his house. And so now David is going to confess and repent. His lies, deceitful scheme didn't work because Uriah didn't sleep with his wife. So when she has her baby bump, everybody's going to say, whose father is that? And yet still David doesn't repent. It says in verse 14, now in the morning, David wrote a letter to Joab and sent it by the hand of Uriah. He had written in the letter saying, place Uriah in the front line of the fiercest battle and withdraw from him so that he may be struck down and die. Can I give you another critical lesson? Abusing one's authority will lead to moral failure. David here, to keep a facade of righteousness, he is now going to execute this righteous man, Uriah, by his enemy's hands. That he's going to send Uriah into the fiercest part of the battle and have Joab withdraw and pull all the troops back and leave Uriah there to be killed by his enemy's hands. Sometimes we'll see someone fall and we'll say to ourselves, well, you know, we're just men, and we're just humans, and this is evil. And trying to make excuses for it. Oh, this is just this is a no, this is evil. And at every turn, God always provides a way of escape so that we can endure the temptation. God here is stopping David at every turn. But once we've yielded to sin as our cruel master, it is a master that none of us can free ourselves from apart from God's grace. Calling out to God, and he's always near. But David won't call out to the Lord. David just kept implementing his plan, leaning on his own understanding, leaning on his own authority, trying to wash away his sin by his scheming plans. And our scheming plans don't wash away sin. And so here he sends this righteous man, and he is executed by his enemy's hands. And it's stunning that David sends the letter with Uriah. He could have sent another servant. But you know why he sent the letter with Uriah and didn't send another servant? Because he knew Uriah was a righteous man, that he had integrity, that the letter was for Joab, so he knew Uriah wouldn't even look at his own death sentence. So David is going to execute him for being righteous by means of his own righteousness. Sin is just that. It's just, instead of trying to rationalize it and justify it, just be, God, help me see what sin is. That when Satan wants to tempt us to go outside the bounds of what God has called good, then instead of us trying to rationalize it, like Eve when she went to the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, she said it was a delight for our eyes and make her wise. Here we stand in judgment over God, saying what God calls evil good. Here David's like, well, having one more wife is good, although she's married. That's how twisted our thinking can be. Well, we're not really depending upon God's grace. And so David is abusing his authority. I think taking Bathsheba was an abuse of authority. I think what he does here to Joab, I think, is abuse of authority. Having Joab kill one of his own soldiers, one of his mighty men. And then seventh, a calloused heart will lead to moral failure. So in verses 22 through 25, it says, so the messenger came and reported to David all that Joab had sent him to tell. And the messenger said to David, the men prevailed, and he's going to get to the point in verse 24 where Uriah was dead. And Joab said, make sure you tell David, the servant, the messenger, that Uriah is dead, or else he's going to lecture you about how war works and why did you get so close to the wall. And David's going to be all like upset, but tell him Uriah has been killed. And then so David responds when he hears that Uriah was dead. And David said this in verse 25. Then David said to the messenger, thus you shall say to Joab, do not let this displease you. And I'm going to translate it literally. Do not let this thing be evil in your sight. What? So he's sending a message back to Joab. Don't let what I have done, don't let what I've called you to do, what commanded you to do, to execute a righteous man, one of our mighty men, don't let that be evil in your sight. Why is that, David? How can you say that that's not evil? Well, it says in the next clause, for the sword devours one as well as another, because people die in war. That's what David. Joab, don't let this trouble you, because after all, it's a war, and people die in war. You know how that happens. We never come back from battle with everybody being saved. It just so happens that people die in war. And so move on, Joab. Don't get stuck on this. Don't let it be evil in your sight. David, he didn't just die fighting a war. David, you betrayed him. David, you betrayed him with your enemy's hands. David, you executed him. David, you executed one of your own mighty men using your enemy's sword so that you could keep a facade of righteousness. You executed a righteous man. And so this is evil. But sin can get us all twisted. And we can feel so justified. Well, my husband's not affectionate enough, or my wife doesn't, you know, she's not intimate with me enough. And that justifies doing evil? So that justifies saying, I know Jesus died for me. I know Jesus gave his life for me. But because I don't get what I want, I don't have to honor Jesus in the midst of my trial and temptation and difficulty. I can turn my back and get and do whatever I want. I can make myself my own little god, and like Satan tempted Eve, I can call good what I want to call good and evil what I want to call evil. And me being happy right now, I'm not happy in this marriage, me being happy right now is good. No, saints, that's not good. What David does isn't good. This is not good at all. And the final critical lesson I think we can learn is in verse 26 through 27. And it's concealing sin will lead to moral failure. So after Bathsheba hears that her husband died, she mourned, it says in verse 26. So she mourns. She's not happy now. Oh, I get a new husband, I get a better husband, I get a husband who's king. She's mourning. And then verse 27 says, when the time of mourning was over, David sent and brought her to his house, and she became his wife, and then she bore him a son. And so it was over. David escaped. And, you know, some people are going to do some of the math. They're going to say, man, she had this baby pretty fast after that wedding. It must have been a honeymoon kind of wedding, pregnancy kind of thing. And so people are like, yeah, because it's King David. There's no way. Yeah. And her husband died. David, no, it's just good. So David covered it all up, and he's good. God's name is not mentioned anywhere in this chapter until the very last clause. And I translated verse 25 literally so you can hear the contrast. It says at the end of verse 27, but the thing David said wasn't evil to Job, don't let this be evil to you, Joab. But the thing that David had done was evil in the sight of the Lord. God saw it. God sees all sins. Our sins will always find us out. Our so-called secret sins are open scandals before God in heaven. All of them are. God sees all of our sins. And so here David's sins are before God. He had seen it all. And so concealing sin leads to moral failure. When we think we can cover up our sin, it leads to more sin. Deeper sin. David should have just stopped at the beginning. Now, sometimes you got to just stop digging the hole and just leave your foot in your mouth and just say, okay, I can't fix that one. Here, David tried to cover up his own sin. And if we can cover up our own sin, then why is Jesus hanging on that cross? Why did God send his only begotten son to hang on the cross if we can cover up our sins with lies? Then the answer is, and here let me make a couple applications. Then the answer really is, and we all have to battle, but the answer is in us being pure and fighting temptation is simply not in us. That's what God sent his son. And God sends a prophet, Nathan, and listen to what the prophet does. He tells David a story. Actually, I'm sorry, it's not just a story. We read it like it's a story. But in 2 Samuel chapter 12, when Nathan comes and he starts to tell him, he's telling him a case. So when there was a difficult case, the kings would adjudicate them. They had like judges, and the judges would adjudicate the cases. But like in a case when Solomon had to decide whose baby it was, they brought that to him. When there were really difficult cases, they would bring them to the king. And this is in this story, listen to it. It's not that complicated, but it has a twist to it. And that's why David thinks that's why it's being brought to him. Nathan says this in verse 2, or verse 1. There were two men in one city, the one rich and the other poor. The rich man had a great many flocks and herds, but the poor man had nothing except one little ewe lamb, which he bought and nourished, and it grew up together with him and his children. It would eat his bread and drink of his cup and lie in his bosom, and was like a daughter to him. Now a traveler came to the rich man, and he was unwilling to take from his own flock or his own herd to prepare for the wayfarer who had come to him. Rather, listen, he took the poor man's ewe lamb and prepared it for the man who had come to him. And here David hears what he believes is a real case. And David says in verse 5, his anger burned greatly against the man. David became completely indignant. Why? Because it's callous. Because it's so hard-hearted. Because it's so ruthless. Because it's so merciless. because it was so ungracious, because it was evil. And so David is outraged. And David says, as the Lord lives, surely the man who has done this deserves to die. So in a case where someone steals and takes someone's land, you just repay it back, maybe twofold. But because of how egregious this case was, it gets brought to David for David to give a verdict. And David says, this sin is worthy of death. And he was right. And he said, and this is his judgment, verse 6, he must make restitution for the lamb fourfold because he did this thing and had no compassion. And David's anger is just boiling. And then Nathan says in verse 7, that David, that is exactly what you just did and worse. David, this story was about you. David, you're the calloused, evil, ungracious man in this story. That God made you the shepherd of his people, and you took a man's wife. David, God made you the ruler of this nation, and you killed one of his mighty men. David, this is you. And so, in way of applying this to ourselves, there's Ecclesiastes says it's not any person who continually does what's right and doesn't sin. So when we sin, we have to hear rebukes. And that's hard for us to do. I get it. The Bible says we need to exhort one another, reprove one another. I'm not going to ask for a show of hands, but how many of you rebuked somebody this last week? I'd be tempted to see a show of hands, have all the pastors turn around and look. No, we need to do that. No, we need to rebuke one another. We need that. That when we start to drift, rebuke me early before I get way over the edge. That there's nothing about any one of us sitting here that we're sin-proofed. That all of us can be tempted and all of us can begin to yield to temptation. But we need to catch it while it's still smoking before the whole house burns down. We need to love each other enough to make our relationships transparent enough and have enough love for each other when we say hard things to each other. And we need to rebuke each other. So Nathan comes and rebukes him. And this is risky business. When prophets would come and rebuke kings, sometimes the kings would kill them. And so here he rebukes David. And David listens. And David listens. But then listen what he has to listen to. So I want to make a second application. Not only humbly receive rebuke, but also you really have to believe this. This sermon has failed if you don't believe this. Listen carefully to the text. And it says, and God begins to speak first person in the middle of verse 7. The Lord, thus says the Lord God of Israel, it is I who anointed you king over Israel. It is I who delivered you from the hand of Saul. I also gave you your master's house and your master's wives into your care, and I gave you the house of Israel and Judah. And if that had been too little, David, had you called upon me, David, had you asked me, David, I would have added to you many more things like these. I wouldn't have added to your harem, but like these. What is it that we lack, that we think that we need, that God won't give us? If he didn't withhold his only begotten son, what is it that God won't give you to keep you from sin? He gave us his son, beloved. He will give us anything. It's good and right that we need for our lives to grow. He gives us everything we need for life and godliness. Satan lied when he said, God is not good, Eve. He's trying to hold you down, Eve. That God knows that if you eat this, your life would be so much better. Satan is a liar. When he tempts us to sin is better. It is a lie. You want to ask, how much does God love you? Well, look at the cross. Not your husband, not your wife, not your singleness. Look at the cross. And you'll just see, God really loves us. We have to believe that. Satan is going to tempt us, but it says in the Psalms, and I love it, Psalm 73:25, it says, whom have I in heaven but you? Besides you, I desire nothing on earth. my flesh and my heart may fail. Your marriage may be failing. And the elders here, they grieve with you. And they want to help you if your marriage is failing. Your hope of getting married, it may be failing. And you can mourn that. But David said, my flesh and my heart, anything else can fail. But God is the strength of my heart and my portion forever. But as for me, the nearness of God is my good. Yes, we don't live in the garden. There's all kinds of things we want and we don't have. There's all kinds of things about this life outside the garden that are difficult. But God will give us grace to sustain us. You can say no. The Bible is clear. The same, and we sang the song that God saves. He's so trustworthy. I've been a Christian now for 40 years, and he's just faithful. He's just trustworthy. He's dependable. He will be there. He will not abandon you. But God is just good. And you can call upon him, and he will help you. There really is nothing that you need that he will forsake you and not give to you. And the Bible makes that clear in Psalm 84. I'll read you one more, and I know I'm looking at the clock. I got to stop. But Psalm 84, 10 through 11, for a day in your courts is better than 1,000 outside. I would rather stand at the threshold of the house of my God than dwell in the tents of the wicked, of wickedness. For the Lord God is a sun and shield. The Lord gives grace and glory. No good thing does he withhold from those who walk uprightly. So I would say, if you are being tempted to yield to sexual sin, it says it in Titus, the same grace that saves, that justifies, and we sang the song, he saves, that same grace will teach you how to deny godliness. God does it by his grace. By his grace, not your strength, not your years in ministry, not your years walking with the Lord. You'll be 100 years old and you'll sin tomorrow if we're not for God's grace. God's grace is what will enable you. And it's true. You just have to believe that. That no matter, I don't care how bad your heart is raging and you go home and you want to click pornography one more time. And I tried, Pastor Bobby, and I tried and I keep failing. I have a question for you. Is the grace of God sufficient today? So you don't have to go home and click. I want everybody to answer that. Is the grace of God sufficient today that no one in this church has to go and click pornography today? Everybody says, amen. Yes, yes. Then let's depend upon his grace. And then you know what I want you to do tomorrow? Just like God gave Israel manna for one day, he'll give you manna for tomorrow. And he'll give you manna for the next day. God will give you grace to say no. And if you've yielded to sexual temptation, then God gives you grace to confess it. Don't do what David did. Don't dig the hole deeper. God will give you grace to confess it. It says in 1 John 1:9, and I'm going to close with this. And it's a classic verse we all know. We can all quote it. I just want to make sure I'm saying it right. 1 John 1:9, if we confess our sins, and this is a conditional, if. And the if part, the conditional part, is saying if you confess, and you can put almost ing after that, if this is just what you do, so much so that it habitually characterizes you as a confessor. So if you're a confessor of your sins rather than hiding and covering it up, if you're a confessor of your sins, and that means that when you sin, you say the same thing God says about it. So had David confessed his sin of lust when he looked and pleaded to God, then it could have stopped there. There are degrees of sin, and this goes as deep as you can go. Then confess your sin when you sin. Don't wait 10 steps later. So here it says, if we are confessors of our sins, saying the same thing that God says, you know what it says? He is faithful. He is dependable. He is reliable. You can rely upon him to forgive us of our sins. If I hand you my iPad and you drop it and smash it and it breaks, and you say, well, Bobby, how much did you pay for it? I'm like, it's okay. My insurance will cover it. I'm good. But if I knew my insurance company would cover it, and I said it cost $3,000, that would be evil. Then I'm going to get my insurance money, and I'm going to take your money. God doesn't require double jeopardy. Jesus paid it all. When he said that the debt is paid on the cross, he really meant it. Or we need to stop singing that Jesus paid it all. Did he pay it all, saints? Then you can confess. He's dependable. He's reliable. He's faithful. It's just, it's the right thing for God to do to forgive. It doesn't mean that there will be no consequences. If he loves you, he disciplines you. And so in the story of David, because he said this fourfold thing, God required of David four of his sons. It is a painful story. God requires much of those who he gives leadership to. And David's, the baby died, Amnon died, Absalom died, and Solomon killed his other brother. And it's just a painful journey. The sword never departed from David's life. And so catch the sin early. Confess the sin early. Better yet, trust God's grace when the temptation comes. That if there's anything we need to learn from this season that we're in, of all of our celebrity pastors falling, I think that God is serious about purity. He's exposing it. And he might be exposing it in kindred. He wants us to be pure. And so we just confess and we repent and we trust the Lord. It's a season where God, I think, is really humbling us and tell us and our society's going porn crazy and it's just every, but we can be pure. And God just wants us to know that by his grace, he can do that. But let's say if you come here today and you're not a Christian and your life is just a wreck morally, then the Bible says that Jesus didn't come for the well. He came for sinners. He came to save sinners. And if you cry out to him, that's why he died. He died to pay a debt we owed. And he rose from the grave, breaking the chains of sin and death. He can give you his victory, but you have to cry out to Jesus, be merciful to me, a sinner. And listen, the gospel is near to you right now. God is in heaven, but he communicates through his word. So you're hearing what God wants you to know through his word right now. So don't harden your heart. Today is the day of salvation. Cry, be merciful to me, a sinner. And he will save your soul. I almost cry when we sing this song, God Saves, because I remember back as a 20-year-old who lived such an immoral life. And I cried out, Jesus, if you can change my life, that's what I want. And I was born again. Instantaneously, I was changed. And now 40 years later, my testimony is the same. God saves sinners. And if you're in here today, you're in the right place. Because everybody around you is a sinner too. You're in the right place. Just cry out to Jesus. And if you're struggling, please don't leave. Talk to your pastors. I have like a really important church meeting. So I'm going to slide through that door. I'm going to jump in my car. But your pastors are here and they love you. I love this church. They love you. Talk to them. Or talk to the person beside you. And if you're doing really well, then grab somebody else and teach them how God is helping you to walk in purity and share your victory and your wisdom. God loves his church. He loves his bride. And he wants us to be a pure bride. So let's fight for our purity. Father, I thank you for this time you blessed us with. You're a good God. And you love us. We are blessed. Help us to just show fruit of how you've blessed us, Lord, and how we live and how we fight for our purity. In Christ's name I pray. Amen. God bless you.